Well, I am Norma Morrison. I'm the lay leader at Wesleyan United Methodist in Muscatine, and I know many of you are familiar faces. I've been around a long time, and I was actually looking back, and it was way back in 2006, 7, and 8 that I actually came and was able to share a message with you way back then. I couldn't believe it's been that many years. But anyway, it's a privilege for me to be here, and I thank you for this opportunity. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, in our time together now, teach us to pray. Through the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, open our hearts and minds and speak to each of us so that we may grow in our relationship with you. Through Jesus, our Savior and friend, we pray. Amen. Can we ever really know all there is to know about prayer? As I was preparing for this message, I couldn't believe all the books on prayer I've accumulated over the years. There was and is always something new God has to show me. It seems that we often focus on what we pray for. My favorite song about prayer is the song Blessings by Laura Story that Keith played before the service started this morning. I love the many examples that she gives us. We pray for blessings, peace, comfort, protection, healing, prosperity, wisdom, to hear God's voice, and we could add many more specifics from our own prayers. There's no denying that some of the blessings in her life. She wrote the number one worship hit, Indescribable, recorded in 2004 by Chris Tomlin, married a handsome athlete the next year, and began working in music and women's ministry at a 4,000-member church in Atlanta. She won a Dove Award and earned two consecutive nominations for Female Vocalist of the Year, all blessings indeed. But what you may not know is, amidst all that success, a brain tumor hospitalized her husband Martin in 2006. The faith she sang about was put through the unexpected fires of fear and loneliness. Most young newlyweds don't imagine being kept alive by breathing machines or having to find their way through significant post-operative vision and memory loss. In an interview about her song, Laura said, "The song shows that we still have more questions than answers, but there's a decision that I find God is asking us to make. Are we going to judge God based on our circumstances? Are we going to choose to interpret our circumstances based on what we hold true about God? Don't get the wrong idea. It hasn't been easy. Everyone wants to be a mature and equipped follower, but would I have signed up had I known what it would take? God has grown us up, deepened our faith, our awareness of our great need for Him as a Savior daily. We knew it before, but we didn't see it. It's devastating when we don't see God's answers to our prayers. We cry in anger when we can't feel you near. What if the very thing that is best for us isn't the same as what we're praying for? All the while, God hears each spoken need. He loves us way too much to give us lesser things. So if He isn't answering our prayers how we think He should, does that mean He isn't answering? Or could it be something else? Could it possibly be that He's really blessing us?" I think that's a lot of wisdom for a then 33-year-old. You can tell by the words to her song that prayer is an important part of her life. Most of you probably don't know that 7 years ago, my husband Bob and I began the most difficult journey of our lives when Bob was diagnosed with a terminal brain disease. I cried out to God in prayer at all times of the day and night. Not only did I pray for healing and getting through each day, but I also prayed for what God wanted for my life. Almost all the ways I had served previously had to be stopped as Bob and I became 24/7 buddies. What now was my purpose for the church? As I was sharing this with a friend, he reminded me of Wesley's covenant prayer that I had prayed in all sincerity so many times. "I am no longer my own, but thine. Put me to what you will. Rank me with whom you will. Put me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be employed for you or laid aside for you, exalted for you or brought low for you. Let me be full, let me be empty. Let me have all things to your pleasure and disposal. Let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and wholeheartedly yield all things to your pleasure and disposal. And now, glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine and I am yours. So be it. In the covenant now made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. All I could say to my friend Tom was, I guess I didn't really mean it. As I have since tried to surrender myself to that prayer, God began speaking to me. It was time to take my commitment to prayer to a deeper level. Praying for the church and for others would be my new ministry. That is my call for the church, and it's a call for every one of us to be more intentional about our prayer lives. If you're anything like me, though, prayers are often rushed, more talking than listening, more empty phrases than spending time in conversations with my best friend. Too often, my prayers sound like this.
In heaven, my neighbor, sin. Hey, Jesus, sorry I'm late. Work was crazy today. No, don't get up. It's okay. Just got a little bit behind. People are being crazy, you know.
That's no problem, Chuck. I'm just glad.
No, I'm glad I made it, too. But listen, let's get down to business. I have a lot of work here, a lot of requests. First things first, pastor and his wife are at a conference. Keep them safe. Not a fan of the assistant pastor. The less he preaches, the better. What else? Ralph, his wife, is getting a tattoo removed. It's a stupid college party way back when. You know how those things go. It's in a real painful spot. I'm not a fan of football here, but my friend is. And if I could have two tickets to take him to show him how cool I am so he'd be my friend some more, that'd be great. My dog Nibbles has a gimp leg.
Jiminy crickets. You know, now that I'm thinking, I could use a new jacket. I'm getting fuzzies all in this one. Please bless
sister. Our Father who art in heaven, my neighbor, Cindy. Hallowed be thy name. Can you sort of train my church to clap on 2 and 4, please? 1 and 3, this is not disco, people. This is serving the Lord. The guy who brings in my shopping cart from the thing, something I can do to get a raise. Can you read what I wrote here? I think I was dreaming. Plus the Secretary of State, the Secretary of Agriculture, the Secretary of Secretaries, bless their secretaries. Thy kingdom come. And that's what bothers me about my mother. Hey, look at the time there. That's gotta get going there. Jesus gonna wrap this up and say amen. Amen. It's been a pleasure praying with you. It's fine evening. I'll be talking with you. Have a good day.
Can anyone relate to that? I certainly can. As we begin to think a little more deeply about prayer, please take out the sermon insert in your bulletin. It's on blue. Thank you, Donna. It makes it easy to find. And so you'll be ready to write. And in the words of the movie, The Wizard of Oz, it's always best to start at the beginning. I invite you to join me in a short exercise that I learned from Chip Ingram, teaching pastor for the radio ministry Living on the Edge. I want you to put your hands together, close your eyes, bow your head. Imagine yourself, you're just ready to pray. You're going to come before the presence of God. But before you thank him, before you confess a sin, before you pray for a friend, before you do anything, here's the question. Who are you praying to? Keep your eyes closed. What's your mental image of God? What's he like? Is he warm, affectionate, inviting? Is he like a principle, a force, distant? Is he like a parent, and no matter what you do, you don't measure up? Is he unconsciously like a Santa Claus, like if you've been good, maybe you'll get an answer, and you won't hear an answer if you've been bad? Is he like a vending machine, handing out whatever we ask for? What are you perceiving? How do you actually perceive God to be? Be as honest as you can. Okay, you may open your eyes, and now if you'd like, jot down one or two things that came to your mind, maybe attributes of God, and that's the first blank there. What is your mental image of God? How do you perceive him? I'll give you just a second to write that down. Maybe you've never thought about that. Every single one of us has a view of God, some from our family of origin, some from our teaching, some from an experience, some from what we've seen on television. We all have a collage in our brains, a picture of how we see God. The problem is, it may be distorted. We may believe God loves us, but he doesn't really like us. The first key to prayer is to get to know God, all his wonderful attributes, and that can only be done as we spend time in Bible study and prayer, time with him as we would any best friend. Number one on your outline is get to know God by spending time with him. And there are blanks to fill in there, so you'll have it. Get to know God by spending time with him. So now that we've thought more intentionally about who we are praying to, then how should we pray? Hear the familiar scripture from Matthew 6, 5 through 13 in the International Version.
And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray, standing in the synagogues and on the street corners, oh, to be seen by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. This then is how you should pray. Our Father, in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one.
Several years ago, I took a lay speaking class about prayer, and much of what I will now share comes from this life-changing book, Let the Whole Church Say Amen. In Matthew 6, 7, Jesus precedes the giving of the Lord's Prayer with this caution: when you are praying, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them. The prayer Jesus then uses is the model of leanness and brevity. There is not a wasted word in it. Number two on your outline, do not heap up empty phrases. Do not heap up empty phrases. I'll guess it. guess Keith will find that eventually. Consider how Jesus did not instruct us to pray. Our Father in heaven, we want to come to you this morning asking that your name might be hallowed. And Father, we also want to ask that your kingdom may come, and we pray earnestly to you that your will may be done, dear Father, on earth in the very same way that it is done in heaven. We pray that you would give us this day the bread, Father, which we need for our day's nourishment, just enough for today, Lord, that is all we ask. And we also want to pray that you would forgive us our many, many serious sins, and on and on. How many times have my prayers sounded just like that? In being somewhat over-polite or even apologetic, am I treating God more as a stranger than a friend or a parent? I find I need to pay more attention to biblical patterns of prayer, prayer without a lot of empty phrases. Psalms is considered the prayer book of the Bible, so that has been a good teacher on my quest to honor God in my prayers. So we begin, our Father who art in heaven, calling on his name once as we begin our conversation together. And then Jesus teaches us to pray boldly, confidently, with what was a new concept to me, learning to pray with vigorous verbs. He provided a prayer model to follow. Give us, forgive us, lead us, deliver us. Number 3 on your outline, pray boldly, confidently, with vigorous verbs. Some may be troubled by prayers that seem so direct, like we're ordering God around. But notice Jesus did not say, let us today find our daily bread. We hope that we can be forgiven as we forgive those who sin against us. Be with us in the time of trial. May we escape evil. Instead, Jesus is giving us permission to be bold, give, forgive, lead, deliver. This goes back to how we answer our first question, how do we perceive God? God is not a stranger whom we must approach timidly. We have the freedom as his children to say boldly what is on our hearts. In learning to pray boldly, my challenge to this day is not to use anemic verbs of prayer or to pray prayers that are contrary to the promises of Scripture. And this may become your challenge as well. Number 4, do not pray contrary to the promises of Scripture. My biggest challenge lies in 2 little words, be with. How many times do I pray, be with so-and-so as she battles cancer, be with the doctors, be with the mission team, be with. Fortunately, most people don't think about it, but it really is bad theology. Jesus said, I am with you always. As we pray for others or in the presence of others, we don't want anyone to question that. We don't need to ask God to be with someone because he already is. So I find myself often stopping myself in prayer. Be with the doctors. No, he already is. Guide the doctors. Grant them wisdom. Give them skill beyond what they have known before. Be with my friend whose parent just died. No. Comfort my friend. Make known your presence. Surround her. Give her strength. Grant her peace. Be with Pastor Joy as she is on leave. No. Refresh her. Encourage her. Use her. Protect her. He already is with her. I have found that by using different verbs, my prayers have become more meaningful, less boring as I pray. The Bible is filled with vigorous verbs, especially in the Psalms, and how I notice them now as I read. I have a list in the back of this book, actually, that I add to, and this is only the beginning. On the back of your sermon notes is a list of vigorous verbs to help you get started. And so we pray, as Jesus taught us to pray, with vigorous verbs and without empty phrases. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. There are so many more things I'm continuing to learn, so many other topics related to prayer that we could explore. Journaling our prayers, having a prayer closet at home or a prayer room at church, prayer lists, prayer chains, how to talk less and listen more. Some of the dreams for my church were to have a prayer room, an email prayer chain, a prayer card in each Sunday bulletin, people praying together at church, praying daily at home for our church. Most of those things are now happening. I want my church to be known as a praying church, and I was so happy to see in your bulletin that that is your desire too. What can you do to continue to make that happen here at Calvary UMC in Walcott? Hopefully this morning we have been challenged to think about what we know about who we pray to and some ideas for how we can pray more boldly. Most importantly, though, why do we pray? What's the most important of all reasons we could come up with? Number 5, we pray because God is worthy of thanksgiving and honor and praise. We pray because God can be our very best friend. We pray because we want to have an intimate relationship with Him that can only come through our time together in prayer. Miss Clara, in the closing scenes of the movie War Room, models for me the powerful keys to prayer from Jesus' teaching. As she prays in secret in her own prayer closet, her friendship and intimate relationship with God overflows. Notice the lack of empty phrases. Listen for the vigorous verbs. I may never pray in the exact same way, but my desire is to pray with the same earnestness and closeness to the Lord. What is your desire for your prayer life? Lord God, grant us this week the desire of our hearts. Teach us to pray boldly so that we may go closer to you. Amen.
And guidance. Raise up a generation, Lord, that will be. You've done it again, Lord. You've done it again. You are good and you are mighty and you are merciful. And you keep taking care of me when I don't deserve it. Praise you, Jesus. You are Lord. Give me another one, Lord. Guide me to who you want me to help. Raise up more that will call upon your name. Raise up those that love you and seek you and trust you. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up. Lord, we need a generation of believers who are not ashamed of the gospel. We need an army of believers, Lord, that hate to be lukewarm and will stand on your word above all else. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up. I pray for unity among those that love you. I pray that you open their eyes so that they can see your truth, Lord. I pray for your hand of protection and guidance. Raise up a generation, Lord, that will take light into this world, that will not compromise when under pressure, that will not cower, Lord, when others fall away. Raise them up, Lord, that they will proclaim that there is salvation in the name of Jesus Christ. Raise up warriors, Lord, who will fight on their knees, who will worship you with their whole hearts, Lord. Lord, call us to battle, that we may proclaim you King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I pray these things with all my heart. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up.
You can, if you want to go ahead and pray, or play, not pray, sorry. Yeah, exactly. Play. If you'd like to stand for a closing hymn, Jesus Loves Me, on page 1.